peeps, welcome back to another episode of Coast2Coast Horror with Crystal and Sasha, with me, your host, Crystal, hailing all the way from Seattle, and...
Hi, I'm Lady Shasha, coming to you from sunny Orlando, Florida.
Where we talk about all things horror from coast to coast and sometimes abroad. Today, we're super excited to be bringing to you guys on location, virtually in Seattle, for the Great Plot Film Fest. It's getting ready to start. We'll meet you back here in intermission. And at the end, we'll talk about the films. Okay, you guys, we're super excited about this. Let's go. All our peeps, welcome back to the Horror Den. In this episode of Live Action Reviews, I'm going to be interviewing the co-host for Grave Plot Podcast and their film festival. So we have, it's right here in my face, Tyler of Terror and Tony Skeletoni. You guys, how did you come up with your names? Those are kind of cool.
I don't know. I was just trying to think of something that sounded like a horror host, like, you know, the old like cheesy public access, late night hosts, and, you know, basically just taking the word skeleton and adding a Y on the end. It just fit.
I so like nice. It. And Tyler, you just added the terror on it.
Yeah, I actually was inspired by the Tower of Terror ride at Disneyland.
I like that. All our peeps, so we are at intermission and we've just watched 10 amazing films. I am going to run through them really quick in English. Sasha is going to tell you what they are in their original titles. And this film festival is like really kind of like off the train so far. So the first movie we watched was a movie from the United States called No Filter.
Hashtag No Filter.
Oh, hashtag No Filter. Thank you. The second movie we watched was from Sweden, and it's called Bloody Hair.
Or Bladukada.
And then number three was out of Spain, called Somebody's Home.
Cases de Algo.
And then number four was Spain or Mexico. I can't remember which was
Italy.
Italy. Okay. Mm-hmm. Which was called Witch's Heart.
Cuore di Strega.
And then number five, which I think is a fan favorite, at least for me and Sasha so far, is called Bloody Bridal 2.
And that one is Despedida da Sangrienta 2.
And then number six was Devil in the Details, which was the United States. Number seven was from the UK, called The Familiar. That was a really beautiful set, and the sound and it was really good.
Yes.
Number eight is out of Mexico, called Hunger.
Hambre.
And then number nine was, I think, UK. Okay. It was called Mind Ease. And that took a left turn like out of nowhere. We were like, what? Like, that one was crazy. So, and then the 10th one was out of France, called Protogen.
Or Progeniture.
Thank you for that, because I would have never been able to do that. So what do you think of the festival so far?
I liked it. And I didn't, honestly, I was pleasantly surprised, because the last film festival I went to, I was like really disappointed because there was just so much over the top pretentiousness going on. And this festival was not like that at all. This actually felt like people who actually love the process of filmmaking and not just the glory of calling yourself a filmmaker.
Right. And
like,
I can't
wait tell to these are people like that enjoy horror.
I know, right? Like, and so that was just for the beginning. So like, we still have 10 more films to go. Out of the first set, like, which one was your favorite?
Out of the first set? God, there's three that I really, really like. Even though I actually missed the first minute or so of hashtag No Filter because I was having technical difficulties, I really like the concept of that one. Also, because I really, really like kind of low-budget horror, and I also am a fan of slasher movies, the Bloody Bridal Shower 2, I liked how campy that was. Like,
and it was like so 70-ish, like.
Yes.
And then I was like, where the fuck did her shirt go? And then
there's a quick clip when the one girl was walking in the woods, the other girls, it's implied that they were making out in the back of the car. And that's why when she comes back.
When she came back from the bathroom, because she was gone for 20 minutes, and then she was in the car, and then like when she fell out of the car, her shirt was off. And I'm like, where the fuck did her shirt go? But that was one of my favorites too. And you said you had one more?
Yeah, familiar, because of the sound design. Like listening to that in headphones, it reminded me of, did you ever see The Haunting, like the original 1960s one?
Yes.
The way that they used noise to show like how the every creak in the house, the sounds of it just was very like classic horror.
Especially the set too, because like that room was so big, but he was so isolated. The only thing that I wish that they didn't do was show the monster at the end, because like
I agree,
for me, I'm a creature feature, but like if your monster is not like top notch, then it's gonna take it away. One of the things, like, I can compare this, not really compare this film to, but there's a, I'll have to like remember what it is because we're running out of time. We got to go back and start our other set. But there was a monster in a movie that I watched in last year's HP Lovecraft Festival down in Portland, Oregon. And that's the way you do a monster. Like once we like get everything going, I will like tag it somewhere so you guys can see that movie. But that was like pretty incredible. So real quick before we have to go back.
Let me say one quick thing about that monster. I thought the design was really good, but it felt like it belonged in a different movie.
Yes, that's exactly what it was. It didn't fit like, right. Yep, you're right. That's exactly what was going on. So my three for the first set is going to be Bloody Bridal, obviously. Mm-hmm. I loved Hunger. And then it's going to be, we have to hurry. Those are the two I'm going to say right now because we're running out of time. So we got to get back in and then we will come back with the last 10. So thanks for hanging out with us. This is super fun and stay tuned. We'll be right back. So the film festival, you guys, how did you get, what made you guys decide to have a film festival?
So we're friends with Steve from the Bone Bat podcast, who runs the Comedy of Horrors Film Festival every year. And I kind of got inspired by that. And then, of course, there's Bleeding Ham up north. And so I came to Tony one day and I said, what do you think about the Grave Plot Film Fest? And his exact words were, sounds ambitious.
So how did you guys, how did it all get started? Because like it's your festival is a little bit different than other ones because you guys only have short films and they are global. So like when you guys first started your call for submissions, like how did you, like, did you know that you only were going to do short films or did that come later or how did that all, like, you know, what was the origin story behind this film festival?
Oh, we knew it was only going to be, go ahead.
Oh, well, at least for me, because I'm kind of like a dollars and cents guy, a lot of it was cost oriented because, you know, we have to rent the theater. And you know, we can only rent it for so many hours before we start digging in, like, you know, I say profits, but really profits are really just what we use to pay for the festival the next year.
Right.
So renting a theater for too long starts digging into those profits. And so it was really just a matter of being able to show as many things in the small window that we had.
And so, it's a local theater, so you guys just like talk to them like, hey, we're gonna do a festival, like what are the costs? Or did you already know that it was just gonna be a day festival with a bunch of shorts?
We talked to a couple different theaters and we finally landed on the Arc Lodge in Columbia City, because the guy who originally talked to, who actually isn't there anymore, but he was very passionate about it. He was a big horror fan. And so it wasn't so much just a cost thing, but it was the fact that he was very passionate about it and he wanted to put it on more than anyone else.
It's really interesting, like even now, like with all the big names and horror being a legitimate genre, that sometimes people still look at us like, no, we don't think so. So that's kind of cool that you guys found a theater that was really passionate about working for you guys. For your first film festival, how did you guys select, or how did you guys even get the word out so that people could submit to you?
We signed up for Film Freeway, and opened a call for submissions on there. They're very good about putting out, you know, email lists and stuff and advertising different festivals. And then we just, you know, put it on our Facebook.
So then once you guys started getting the selections in, how did you guys select which films you were going to show? And then I know that you guys have just one or two judges. So like, how did that all work? Like, did you guys be like, okay, we want one from a different, you know, one film from each different country or in different genres, or was it the caliber of the film? Was it the originality? Or like, how did you select, how do you guys select the films that you're going to judge for your film festival?
It's a lot of grunt work. I know that first year, what did we get, like almost 300 submissions?
Wow. Yeah.
And we just sat down and watched them all. And, you know, like we said, Film Freeway is actually a very good resource for people putting on festivals. They have a rating system. And so basically, yeah, each, you know, we just watch a film and rate it, you know, and it has different parameters or it has an overall rating you can give it. And so we just went through each one, rated it, and then picked the best of the best.
And so
regardless of where they came from.
Okay, so then did you always only have 20 films? Was that like a goal of your guys to be like, okay, we're only showing 20 films, we only have 4 hours, or did that come over time?
It's more just a time thing, more so than the number of films. You know, we have an intermission in between, and we have to have time for awards at the end. So we just kind of look at around 3.5 hours or so, and however many fits into that. Like this year, we have a lot more longer films. So we have a 15-minute limit. And this year, we have several that butt right up against that 15 minutes, whereas in the past, we had some that were like 2 or 3 minutes.
Mm-mm. And so when you guys are like, so you guys select them, or like, are you guys judging and selecting at the same time? I'm familiar with Film Freeway because I'm a sitting judge on four festivals, so I know how that works. But like, by the time we're judging, they've already selected the film. So are you guys selecting and judging at the same time?
Yeah, so we have two tiers of judging. We have a selection committee, which we sit on. And just depending on the year and how many people we can get to participate in it, I think we've had, what, like 5 or 6 different selection judges. This year, we just had the two of us to pick. And then, yeah, all those selections end up going in, and the winners, those go on to our overall judges that pick the winners for the individual categories.
And then, like, I know I'm familiar with the judging, like with the scoring system. And I remember 1 year up in Bleedingham, he called an emergency meeting because the way that we had judged them, we had like a 3-way tie. And so basically we were sequestered to try and break that tie. Because and that year, like the films that won, they won by like points, like 0 point, you know what I mean? And so do you guys, like, because like I've been doing film festivals for a long time, but like the quality of the films just kept getting better and better and better and better each year. And judging sometimes, like when we're like with not with you guys, but with the regular judges who are going to be saying, you know, first, second, and third place, like sometimes our debates, you would think if you saw us that we would be like, we were arguing the fate of a condemned man, right? Not over movies. It's pretty heated, but like the quality of films are just getting so much better each film festival that judging becomes really stressful, like extremely stressful, especially with some of these bigger festivals. Like I have 260 films to judge with just one festival alone, and all of these films so far, no one has gotten lower than a 9. So like it's like stressful. Wow. For to judge. So like, are you guys feeling that same way when you're selecting them?
Yeah, I've always kind of fancied myself like a pretty harsh judge. I mean, it's just in the nature. I mean, like, you know, we'll get submissions that are, there's a lot of heart in them. You know, you can tell that the filmmakers really did what they could with what they had available. And, you know, I give them credit where credit's due. But, you know, unfortunately, when you're right, going up against things that are just of higher production value, you know, better acting, you know, this and that. It just got to be basically, you know, judge with a strong hand.
Almost brutal in your selection, yeah.
Yeah, and I believe 1 year we actually did have to bring in an extra judge to break a tie, didn't we?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my dudes, we just got done watching all 20 films for Grey Plot Film Fest 2022, dudes. Oh, my God. So let's get into the second set of 10. So the first one was Diarrhea Out of Mexico.
Called Salpicón.
The second one was Secession from Italy.
No, Spain.
Spain, okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, Spain. And then number 13 was
Tekenshu.
Tekenshu out of Mexico. Number 14 was The Mill Creek Strangler. Number 15 was The Nick. Number 16 was The Stitcher. Number 17 out of Mexico was Uncle.
Theo.
And then number 18 from the United States was Wait for My Call. Number 19 also from the USA was Witch. And then number 20 from France again was Zimila.
I can't say it. Zimiana?
Okay.
That's what it looks like. Zimiana.
So out of the second set, which ones were your top three?
Top three of the second set would probably be I think Tekenshu.
Yep.
Teal, but just because of how great it looked. Like, I like stop motion, and it's not something that is done a lot, but definitely a top one, Zimiana. I love the effects in that, and the sound effects were really good too.
So my three out of the second is going to be Secession, The Mill Creek Strangler. Like, I usually don't like comedy and horror, but that one's kind of off the chain. And then there's a tie between Uncle and The Stitcher just because of what The Stitcher was doing. So let's talk about it. So this is a really cool festival. I think it would have been like, I'm glad that they put it online because then we were able to go to it together. But I think that this type of festival, just the way that they're like hella chill, would be a cool festival to go to in person.
I agree. Do you want to talk about each of the movies starting from the first one to say a couple more things about each one?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So before we do that, what are your top three out of all 20?
Out of all 20, I would still say hashtag no filter. Yeah, hashtag no filter. Bloody Bridal Shower 2 and Familiar as far as... Oh, God, wait.
I said all of them.
Had a few slow parts. It's hard. I really like... You know what? I'm going to take off hashtag no filter and make the top three. Bloody Bridal Shower 2, Familiar, and Zimiana.
So my top three out of all 20 is going to be Bloody Bridal 2, it's on the second one is going to be, where did it go? The Mill Creek Strangler. I usually don't like comedy and horror, but this was so off the top. It was crazy. And then my third, I have a tie. Like, I can't pick between the two of them. And that's going to be The Stitcher and Uncle Teo from Mexico. So let's start from the beginning.
Yes.
What did you think about No Filter? Hashtag No Filter.
Mm-hmm. I love the concept, especially when you see how much can be done with filters. Like, it's wild. I could almost see that becoming like, well, not necessarily enough for it to be a movie, but enough for it to be a half an hour episode of an anthology series. I think that would have made a really good anthology series. And I like, you could tell that it didn't have a whole lot of money for the practical effects, but they did have, whoever did the practical effects still has a lot of talent because they did the best they could do with what they had. And I think they did a lot.
I like the concept of it, that because like We really don't. Like, especially like me, I use Snapchat to take selfies to post them all over because I like the filters. But like that filter was hella extreme. But luckily, if I'm in the right lighting, like if I'm outside, like when we were in Florida, I didn't use a filter at all because the light was like,
oh, it's perfect down here.
But like when I'm like, if it's raining or if I have like this kind of light, it's kind of like dark in here, I will use a filter, but not to that extreme. One of the things that I thought that was like kind of cool about that movie was once you use that filter, it's almost like selling your soul because they were doing things outside of their integrity. You know, like she was like, why did you, like, it was like night and day. Like it was like their Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. It was like really, it was a really cool concept. And I liked that movie a lot. Mm-hmm. And then, so for bloody hair.
Mm-hmm. I found out some information about that. I'll read one paragraph because I Googled it because, you know, I didn't know about this particular mythology. Mm-hmm. But it says, in Norse mythology, the wave maidens, also known as the billow maidens, are the nine daughters of Ran and Aegir, the goddess of and the god of the sea. According to Patricia Monahan, these maidens were Scandinavian giantresses. They were portrayed as beautiful maidens dressed in white robes and veils and always helped their father brew beer for the gods. Their names are poetic terms for the many different characteristics of the ocean waves. So the one that's named Bladughada, her name means bloody hair, and it represents a certain time of the year when the waves come ashore and there's like a red foam on the top.
I think that's from the algae, because here in Washington and in parts of Alaska, our sea turns red too, but it's like little particles that are swimming through it, and when the sun bounces off of them, the water looks red. What I didn't like about Sierra, is the concept that men will just walk up and be sexually involved with some random person in the wilderness or in a dark barn. She kind of reminded me, she made me think of like the sirens, but like, are guys really just led by between their legs? Like, why would you just go up to someone that you find in the middle of the woods naked? One, so like you're not thinking maybe she's in trouble, and two, just to be like rubbing all over her and be like, oh, boom, chow chow. Like, what?
I think he's meant to have been enchanted, because when he was walking through the forest, he heard her singing first. And if her mythology is similar to our sirens mythology in the West, the men, they are enchanted by the sound, so they're kind of like in a trance.
Okay, that makes
sense. I think he's meant to be in a trance. I just think that they didn't communicate that well. They should have communicated that something, have the actor do some gesture that would show that he is in a trance, that he's not just walking up, you know?
Yeah, because that's what he seemed like to me. He was just like, ooh, hey.
Yeah.
And so then that was number two. So number three, Somebody's Home, the twist in that, like, there was no way we could have saw that coming. We were both like kind of like texting each other when that happened. We're like, what in the hell? And so it's about a woman who her dog got killed by a werewolf. And so she's got this guy locked in a cage, chained up in her bathtub. And he's like, it's not me. But then when the full moon comes, like, it's almost she got her dog back, because I guess the essence of her dog was in their werewolf. Because when she unchained him, I was like, why are you unchaining the werewolf? But then he was just like crying, like how, you know, dogs are like whimpering and it's sad. And he put his head in her lap. And then I was like, what? Oh my God, she got her dog back. And because I'm a dog person, I was just like, okay, I cannot cry because I'm on mascara. But and another thing that was kind of cool was, so as the credits were rolling up, they had drawings at the end. Like, if you guys have seen the new Candyman, how at the end, at the credits, there was a whole another little movie. They did the same thing with this one too. And I loved it. I thought it was just like kind of heartwarming. It was a very original, like a nice twist on the werewolf trope, because I've never seen that done before.
I didn't like the ending because I'm a cat person and I didn't want to think of what the werewolf did to the cat.
Right. Right. Okay, what number are we on? Number four. Hmm. So what'd you think?
That one was very, very short. But I kind of like the design of the mushrooms. I should recount what it's about. It starts out with this man running through the forest, and he's being chased by these other men who are accusing him of being a witch. And he's like,
I like that part because, like, it's kind of nice to see, like, because men were burned as witches too. So, like, I was super happy to see that the, like, when they were calling him a witch, I was like, oh, okay, well, this is nice. This is different. Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
And they say a poem about if you find these red mushrooms in the forest, that they're called the witch's heart. And he accidentally steps on one as he's running away from these men. And it activates something in him that actually makes him into a witch, I guess.
He was already a witch. It made him worse. Like, it kind of made him a demon.
Oh.
You know what I mean? Because he was already being accused mm-hmm. of a witch when he was running. And so... And then, like, it was kind of interesting because when he woke up...
But that doesn't necessarily mean he was a witch. Being accused of witchcraft doesn't mean you were one. It's like by them chasing him into the forest and him stepping on a mushroom, they created the thing that they call themselves being afraid of.
Girl, that's right. Oh, my God. One of the things that I liked about his transformation is when, after he stepped on the mushroom, and then he kind of, like, rose from the earth like a mushroom... Mm-hmm. And I liked that. And then it seems to be a poisonous spore, because when he exacts vengeance, there was another one that grew up out of the earth. And I was like, oh, this is good. Like, I liked that. And then the second mushroom had a really nice butt.
I had to think about that one for a second. What's the next one?
The next one is...
just one of our favorites.
Yes. Bloody Bridal number two.
Bloody Bridal Shower.
Bloody Bridal Shower. Dudes, this one is like, it's so like a nod to the 70s, late 60s, mm-hmm. early slashers. It's crazy. Like, the girls, all of a sudden are not dressed, and there's beheadings. And I knew when that first girl got her head cut off, I was like, this is right up Sasha's alley. I know she's mm-hmm. over there just super happy about it.
Yes, the way some of the film work that was done, or some of the cinematography, kind of reminds you of Texas Chainsaw Massacre, but the kills remind you more of like Friday the 13th.
Yes.
Despite the name of Texas Chainsaw Massacre, you really don't see a whole lot of massacre in that movie. Like, the title is more graphic than the actual movie. The other thing is some of the things that they did in After Effects, where they added those little scratches to make the film look like it had deteriorated, like it was mm-hmm. from the 1970s. And it had, even their dialogue had kind of a grindhouse feel to it.
It really did. Cause I was like, wait a minute. And then, speaking of camera work, I want to bounce back to The Witch's Heart, because the camera work in that was kind of cool when they were chasing him mm-hmm. through the forest, and they did that, like, reverse, I don't know, it must have been a drone and then a guy who popped up. Like, I was really impressed with the camera work in The Witch's Heart. But back, just because you mentioned the camera work here in our Bloody Bridal Shower. So mm-hmm. this movie is, there's a girl, and it follows the whole entire early horror movie troupe. She got the virgin, the good girl, right? And you have the bad girl, and then you have, like, the stoner chick. And so the good girl chose these two bad girls to be her bridesmaids. So they're driving the long way in the dark to get to where they're going to get married. And she has to go to the bathroom, but like in crazy fucking stupid shit that 70s horror movies do, she's 80s. Yeah, she's
because 70s, the 70s slasher movies, they had some conventions, but they didn't get into the stupidville that the 80s slasher movies.
Right. Okay. Right. So yeah, she goes off into the wilderness to go to the bathroom, but she's gone for a long ass time. Like, she's deep in the, like, there's no one out there, go to the back of the car, squat it out, you know, and then
yeah,
get back in the car. But she was like, you know, wandering through the woods, like foraging and shit. Like, how far was she away from the car? Long enough for the two girlfriends to like get it on. And I was just like, how far does she have to go pee? Like, really? And then that's when everything goes wrong, because like, you know, they get separated, because like after the sexy deed is done, which I kind of like the way they did that, because it wasn't so like, it wasn't kind of like with the male gaze, you know what I mean? It was just like suggested, and then like, of course, like that's a reason for them to show them without their shirts on. And so the girl, one of the girls is in the trunk, the other girl's laying in the back seat, and then the killer comes out of nowhere, and then everything that Sasha loves happens after that. So The Devil's in the Details is number 6. It is,
which was animated,
and I fucking loved this because it was just so silly. So we have I guess she's just like a goth girl who fell in love with a fucking vampire, and
she tries to summon Satan, and it's so funny because she says, "Satan, get him," but instead of Satan,
she
Stan comes,
right? Because she like she used like these fucking what are those game Scrabble squares, right? To like spell out the name of Satan. And when she stood up, because the vampire saw the key, and so he comes in and announced, and she stood up and she kicked the one of the words off of
the A. She kicked the A out.
There's this little fire, and then like someone pops up and she's looking up and she's like, what? And it's this little tiny real estate agent, and he is like the realtor from hell, because he's so then they start fighting. He's like, you summon the devil for me. And so then they get into this big old lover's quarrel, and this realtor is just walking around the house looking at all the like details. He's like, oh, granite tower countertops, and look at this big bathtub, and they're fighting, and then he opens the curtains. He's like, look at all this natural lighting. And then the vampire fucking dies, burned into the sun.
And I like the wordplay, the one letter difference from Satan to Stan.
And then he put it back because he's like kind of like a, he might have like ADHD, I think the little realtor did. So he put the letter back, and then there was a giant fire, and then Satan came, and true to being a salesman, he's like, this house is perfect for a man of your stature. And I'm like, what? It was really, I liked it. It was just like so silly. I liked it a lot. Okay, so what's next, love?
Familiar from the UK. And it starts with a black screen that just says Blackwell, Pennsylvania, 1942. And they did a great job with that opening music, because that music is from that era. Speaking of sound, the sound design was amazing. We talked about this during the intermission. Just having my headphones on, I'm so glad I listened to it with my headphones, because just everything from the footsteps, the creaking of the doors and the floors,
just the scratching sound that, to the records.
Yeah. Every little, they gave your, it was like something for your ears to eat, if that makes sense. It was really, really great.
She had an eargasm.
You also mentioned the set design, which was really, really well. And when we were messaging back and forth, I think what really amplified how well the set design was done was the camera shots, because they were, I mean, I like symmetry. That's one of the things I've always liked about watching like a Stanley Kubrick film, I can't remember the gentleman that did the Royal Tanning Bombs. And
then the director for The French Inside.
Yeah. There's a director. Why can't I remember his name? Somebody in the comments, tell me the director of the Royal Tannenbaums and, I'm trying to think of his other films. He always does things very symmetrical, and it just looks gorgeous. And this director, the shots were similar, and it made everything look great, and also how they used lighting. A lot of the lighting was a warm, like white light, until it was time to show the creature, and then it switched to this cool blue light. And the way the entity, we'll call it an entity, was backlit, it looked so creepy. And I would have made this like top notch number one, except for the one thing at the end. And what was that, Crystal?
They showed the monster. So I am a huge ass creature feature. I love monsters. I love bad guys and I love villains. The problem is, though, in my opinion, if your monster is lacking in any type of funding or any type of, like, if you have a super low budget and you can't afford the CG and the makeup and the FX team, then it's better to not have a monster at all. The monster, but like when we were at intermission, Sasha made a point that the monster didn't match the movie.
Yeah, the movie gave
the monster wasn't bad. Like the monster was beautifully designed, and but it was just he didn't match the scene. He didn't match that scene. Like, if you guys get a chance to see this, if they ever put their movie on Altar and you get to see this film, it's a gorgeous Victorian set, really beautiful. The lighting, the furniture, the set, the music, everything. And then the monster seems like he's from like the 1990s. It just he didn't match. And he looked like he came from the water.
Yeah, it's like if you made The Haunting or The Innocents from the 1960s, and then you put the creature from the Black Lagoon in it.
Exactly. Yeah, and normally you guys know when I do live action reviews, I do a 1 to 5 star rating. Mm-hmm. This movie was a 5 all the way up until they showed the monster. Mm-hmm. And like a lot of films have that mistake. One of the first ones I remember just like being super mad about was Signs. That movie took a nosedive the minute we saw the monster. Like, we should have not seen, like, all we needed to see was that little glimpse of him when he was in the closet saying, "Vomino, children, vomino." Like, that's all we needed to see. But like, they showed the full monster. It kind of cheapened the whole movie. This one didn't cheapen the entire movie because it was right at the end. It just didn't match. He just didn't match.
I would have just left it in silhouette because it was really creepy when it was just in silhouette.
Right. Okay, so number 8
is Hambre.
Hunger. This movie is so fucking stressful and kind of like annoying. Okay, so it opens up with this little kid throwing food down a well, and the well sounds like a grumbling stomach. And it's a nice metaphor for how he feels because he's very thin. He's very malnourished. And when we follow him home, his fat ass big brother is eating all the food like his mom. Okay. So instead of feeding them both at the same time, she feeds the big one first and then she feeds the little one. But the big one takes his plate when the mom turns her back. And this was happening all through the movie. And so he was doing desperate things to try and eat. Like the first thing he did was he tried to steal some eggs from a farm, but there was a pit bull there that was guarding. And most farms do have guard dogs just for that reason. They don't want their livestock stolen. And so he distracts the dog, he steals 2 eggs, we're all excited for him. And as he's running, goddammit, he fell and crashed his eggs. I was like, sent her a message, and I was like, fuck! And she was like, right! Like, we were just like, can't this kid get a break? And so then we see him back at home, his fucking little brother, his big brother is eating all the food, his mom's not paying attention. And the next thing he does is he is sharpening a steak. And so we're like, oh my God, he's gonna kill the fucking dog. But he didn't, he killed a chicken and he roasted it up, and his fat ass little brother smelled it from inside the house. And so there's this like chase scene, which is crazy because all the dogs in the fucking village start chasing. And at the end, there was a cat that was chasing the dogs for the chicken. And it looks like the little brother is not gonna be able to eat, but he lured him to the well and put the chicken there as bait. And he tried to push him over the well, but his brother is 4 times bigger than him. This is a tiny, scrawny little kid. So he gets to the well and he tries to push him over, but he's 4 times bigger than his little brother. So there's a fight. And finally, the big brother gets his just due and the little brother gets to keep his dinner. So like like the desperation of hunger is very terrifying. Like that, I can see. I mean, it's a perfect horror movie. The well, that giant chasm that can't be filled, was like a perfect metaphor about how this kid was like living his life, and like he was very thin and very, you know, scrawny and just underfed.
I also like how they showed the well. There were some scenes where you could see the well and it had like fog coming out of it and light. And it's just amazing how much you can do with just a fog machine and some lights.
And then how he like put stones in the well to try and like sate it, and the well threw the stones back out very angry. So like that was kind of like him like trying to like find like just the crumbs to eat and not being satisfied. It was really good. The next movie, number 9, was Mind Ease, mm-hmm. which, you know what, it took a turn for the left, like in the, like when we weren't even expecting it. So you want to tell us about it?
Oh, yeah. I really like this one. It starts out with this woman who's frantically moving around her apartment, and she's looking for these tapes to listen to. And I'm thinking, is she having an anxiety attack? Is she having a panic attack? And
so she was.
We're led to believe that that's what she was. But I like when she started playing the tape and it says, you know, something to the effect of, you should be able to hear this on your left side, you should be able to hear this on your right side. And I like that they added her stopping the tape and then switching her headphones around, because how many times do you have to do that? That was realistic. But the tape is not working to calm her down, so then she shuts it off. But the voice continues, and then it starts to curse her.
Like in between her calming voice, like mm-hmm. it's telling her calming stuff, but then in between it's telling her some fucked up shit. And
it's shifted. It wasn't in between. It was a gradual shift. Oh, where it's okay. Telling you to breathe, and then suddenly he's like, because you know you're an effed up bitch. I'm paraphrasing. These are not the actual words, but so the voices continue to talk to her and tell her about herself and call her names. And then the camera pans around to her, from her sitting on the ground to what I believe to be is the ghost of her ex sitting on a terrace. And he has a knife where it's implied that she stabbed him in the head.
Right through the eye,
and he's sitting there with these house shoes on. He's like, okay. No, I couldn't stop looking at
him. She texted me and she's like, look at his house shoes. And I was busting up laughing, like, mm-hmm. and then I was like, because she had a cute sweater set on, I was like, yeah, I want that sweater set. And then fucking Sasha sends me a fucking link to where I can buy it. I'm like, how do you know? Like, oh my god, like Sierra. Yes. I'm sorry.
And I didn't realize it was a period piece until they showed him, because he had a butter. Well, I don't know. Maybe it's supposed to be current day.
Remember the chair in the dining room when it spun around and no one was in it? It's kind of mm-hmm. platty. And then the colors like kind of like make it seem like.
Yeah. And he had a butterfly collar on.
Yeah.
So I think it was supposed to be the 70s or late 70s, probably 1979. Cause people still wore butterfly collars, but Sony Walkmans were available. Cause Sony Walkmans, I don't think they were available in the early 70s. I don't think that was a thing until late 70s.
Right.
But yeah. And I love the color palette of that too.
Very bright. But like dated almost. Cause I think mm-hmm. it was supposed to be in the 70s. So number 10, Protogen, we're just gonna have to guess, because it was in French and we had no subtitles. And even during right after intermission, they were like trying to explain what happened. Mm-hmm. So from my guess, these neighbors wanted to steal the sperm of their neighbors, which was like kept in a vial mm-hmm. under like this dome, like, and so like why that was like that, we don't know, because there was no subtitles. And so what they do is they break in while the couple is sleeping. But then there was like this, did you see the guy that came out of the shadows? Like, why are you?
I missed that. I didn't see a guy come out of the shadows.
Oh, yeah. So when they first came into the house and they're like trying to figure out what to do, behind the wife, this guy comes out of the shadows and she spins around and she sees him and she tells her husband, but I guess he said, don't worry about him because the sperm is more important. So I'm thinking mm-hmm. maybe this is a couple that is having fertility issues, and so mm-hmm. They go and they steal it. The couple wakes up and
they confront them and they're like, you can't have this sperm. Right. And then so the guy is like, well, if we can't have it, then nobody can, and he drinks it. Which is like, Why'd you do that, dude?
It was so fucking gross. And then his stomach popped open like John Carpenter. But what came out was a chicken.
Yeah, at first it looked really cool until he pulled it all the way out and you can tell there was a chicken. Because at first when you couldn't tell what it was, I was like, oh, that's gross.
Was like going around.
Yeah, I was like, that looks cool. But then they should have cut right then.
Right,
but
right. Again, the film, monsters, and you can see don't the show the wing. Monster. Yeah.
Well, don't show too much of the monster because it did look really cool at the beginning, but they showed too much of the monster. And that's when your mind's eye can go, oh, wait, that's like a roasted chicken.
It really was. Yeah,
don't give people's mind enough time to figure out what it is you're showing them.
Because like when they flashed it, when he was like dying, it kind of looks like something like out of like maybe a twist from Aliens and The Thing.
Yeah.
Like, you know, absolutely a head nod to that because it burst right out of his stomach. Mm-hmm. Really good practical effects. But the zooming in of the chicken fucked it up. Then we just don't know because we didn't have, there's so much loss in translation because I don't speak French. She understood only about 10%. So
yeah, because I took French in high school, but I graduated like over 25 years ago, I'm pretty sure. So yeah, I understood a few words that were enough to give a context, but.
Okay, so that was the first block. And so then after intermission, the first film that we got to see, which I didn't like, was out of Mexico called Diarrhea.
Mm-hmm.
And so what did you think about it?
I learned how to say diarrhea in Spanish now. So sal picón. Okay. That's what I learned. I liked the creature design, but it didn't do anything that any other... in the movie, they called them... cannibales, like they're cannibals, zombies. But they're zombies. They're just like, I didn't see anything really different. You just wanted to make a zombie movie. Mm-hmm. I'm getting the impression of that one. Sometimes what you get is you get a person that's really, really good at practical effects, but they're not a great writer. Right. So I didn't get to write down the crew or anything. So I don't know whether the person that did the effects was the same person as the director, but it almost felt like the person that did the special effects was the director. And it's a good showcase of your special effects, but there wasn't enough story there for it to be a short film.
And plus, I'm a germaphobe, and it's gross because it takes place in a like gas station bathroom. Mm. So like all the dirt and grime that you would expect to be in a gas station bathroom is highlighted. It was just like, and I don't like zombies, so like it was not, that one was like, the only one, wait, is it the only one? No, there's another one that got, if I was to rate it on live action reviews, it would have gotten 2 stars because it just didn't do anything for me. Mm-hmm. Number 12, Succession. I fucking loved this movie. It is a haunting at first, but then you find out it's a spell. Like, and the way that it was, okay, so I think, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think what happened was, this family was in a car accident and the daughter died and the father was having a really hard time adjusting to life without her. What parent wouldn't? And so we get to listen to the phone call or the message that his wife left him. And she's like, you know, just spend some time in the house. It's going to be good for you. You'll see when we get back together. So when he's in the house, he starts like seeing her. And the first thing that kind of like the hint that this might not be a haunting is when he called his wife and he's telling her, he's like, I see Diana here. I know that she's here. And her response was, don't worry, nothing's wrong. And I was like, that's a weird thing to say to your husband who thinks he's seeing your dead daughter. But as the movie progresses, we find out why. Cause like when they're on the phone, it's just, we see him. And then when he hangs up the phone, the camera goes to her where she hangs up the phone and then she's dressed in white and there's tons of candles and there's all kinds of magic amulets laying around. And I was like, oh, now this is interesting. Mm-hmm. And so he decides that he can't take it and he tries to leave, but he hears his daughter's voice upstairs. He was this close to safety. And he goes back upstairs. He goes into the room, he's locked in. And then in the morning, who comes out is their daughter. And she runs outside and hugs her mom. The mom is looking up at the window as they're walking away. So I think the mom blames the dad for whatever happened. It was a life for a life.
That one, I didn't really, it didn't connect with me that much, but it looks good.
It was, yeah. Okay, number 13, Chica, because you know I can't say.
Oh, yeah, that one I'm going to have to say anyway, because I think your computer froze up or something when this one was playing. The Tekkenchu from Mexico?
Yes.
Yeah. It starts with an injured miner being lost in the forest, and two young girls find him, and they bring him back to safety. They put him in bed. He's injured. He has, like, scratches on his face. And
deep scratches, so like, from an animal, like maybe a bear.
So they stitch him up and they get him, you know, back together. But then they ask him, you know, there's a girl named Maria that's been missing. And other girls have gone missing. Do you know anything about it? And he's like, I wouldn't know anything about that.
But the way he was staring at the little girl in the room, like, I was like,
her mouth.
Yeah, because I was like, he's not normal. Like,
no, he kept on dangerous. Staring at her mouth and they kept on doing close-ups of her mouth. Yeah. And then it comes out that they say, well, when the girls are found, they're found without their teeth. And mutilated in other ways. So they end up throwing him in the back of a truck. They take him back out to the woods. And, oh, I forgot to mention, he cuts their hands off and he takes their teeth. So they bring him out to the woods. They put this mask on him. And all the other people in the town come down there. And they are waving these hands, these severed hands. And it's probably severed hands of their loved ones that went missing. And he's yelling, oh, I didn't do it. Then this creature... who is, I guess that's the Tekkenchu. It'd be kind of like, the way that it sounded, it made you think of like the Wendigo.
Mm.
So that type of forest creature type of thing, it literally just comes and gets his ass. And then you get a flashback to him doing what he did to these children, because he was the one that was killing the children.
Wow.
And taking I'm their so teeth bad, and cutting their
I
did, hands
I, like I saw up until... he was like, when I saw up until he was in the truck and the little girl covered his face, and then my computer came back on when he was sitting in front of the villagers, and then that was it. I was like, this looks so good, fucking hell. So like that one I didn't get to see, so I can't tell you about it. So number 14, the Mill Creek Strangler. So I do not like comedy and horror mixed, but every once in a while, someone comes along to make me a fucking liar. So the Mill Creek Strangler in this little film, he breaks into this woman's house and she bursts out of bed all excited. She's like, I'm your biggest fan. And she turns on the light and she's pointing to the other wall against her bedroom. And he turns around and she's got like almost like a how you see detectives putting up pictures and strings for like, you know, each different like crime scene, but hers is all glittery and like she's totally fangirling, and they have like this whole ass conversation. She's trying to figure out like why he's doing it. She's telling him some of the theories, and then she's getting dressed because she's like, you know, excited that she's gonna be his next victim. And she creeps him out. So like at the part where he's gonna kill her, she's like looking right into his eyes and he's choking her. But like after this whole entire time, I guess he felt connected to her. And then he kind of like backs up and she's like, no, don't stop. I'm almost there. And then he's like, nope. And he leaves and she's like against the window, like, no, Shane, come back. Like, I was just like, what in the hell? That was super good. I liked that.
I think she freaked him out. She really freaked him out.
She really did. Because from the very beginning, because he was like, what the hell? Like, why aren't you screaming? Why aren't you trying to get away? Like, what's going on? So, yeah.
Now, we talked about our most liked, but this is one of my least liked.
Mine too.
It's called The Nick and it's from Australia. And it starts with a woman cutting vegetables in the dark, which why are we in the dark cutting vegetables?
It's our
She nicks her finger and apparently when she sucks on her own blood, it like seals her mouth closed.
Well, no. Remember one drop dropped in the kitchen. Mm-hmm. And then she went into the bathroom to try and find a Band-Aid and she couldn't. Mm-hmm. And so her mouth didn't seal until she put her fucking hand in that puddle. Remember?
Oh, I thought her mouth was already sealed when she put her mouth
in the puddle. No, because she, like, in the bathroom, she couldn't find Band-Aid. I don't know why she didn't just use tissue. And so she's like, she puts her finger in her mouth and then she's like, okay. And then she goes back out, going back to the kitchen, and she sees this giant puddle of blood on the floor. And she's kind of like, well, that's interesting, thinking to herself. And then this girl, she kneels down and she puts her whole entire hand into this like inch thick of blood. And then she's stuck there. And when she tries to pull her arm up, she falls onto her elbow, and that's when her mouth is closed. And so she's like doing all this stuff, trying to like pull herself free from the puddle, and she doesn't.
Like, yeah, it's so like strange. It's like a tar glue type thing, and I don't know, it just didn't make a whole lot of sense. Again, I'm putting this in the same category of what was the other one we talked about, Salpicón, where you have a person who wants to do special effects, and that works great, but you don't have a writer.
And the special effects like, weren't that great. It kind of reminded me of that Stephen King movie where the kids swam out to the dock, and that thing was like that. Yeah,
that's from Creepshow 2.
Yeah, Creepshow 2. So yeah, that's all that it was. Like, mm-hmm. But it was just kind of weird that it was in her house. So yeah, that was our least favorite.
That's one of my least favorites. That's not the least favorite. I have one.
That's my least favorite.
I dislike more than that one.
Ooh, okay. Okay, so the next one I think we both really liked, it's called The Stitcher. Mm-hmm. And you want to tell us about it since you're in Florida?
It's very tongue-in-cheek. It starts off with this lady that she's at the park and she's going by these people and they look at her.
Dogging.
Yeah, and they're just like, why don't you have a mask on? And so she starts, you know, saying all the talking points that anti-maskers like to use. She likes to say fake news, and she calls them afraid of the world, and, you know, normal Karenisms. Right. And they even call her Karen because she won't shut up and leave them alone.
Like when he was trying to walk away from her, she was goading him. And so she was calling him all these different names, and she was saying, you know, you're an unfit father, and he wasn't responding. And then she's like, and your dog is fucking ugly. The dog is not ugly. Like, and then then she got the reaction that she wanted. Mm-hmm. And so, but like, it was really interesting because like she's jogging through the park, breathing like joggers do, and so they zoom in on her face and her nose and mouth, and then they pan out at everyone in the park. Everyone is wearing a mask, some people are wearing two, and then the little girl was like, we have
Stitcher's gonna get you.
And she was like, not only are you a bad parent, but you're giving your kid nightmares. And so the Stitcher, when he was in the window with his hat on, do you remember that scene from, I think it was the second Poltergeist, or maybe the third Poltergeist, where the Amish guy was looking in the window, like when he was by the window? That was one of the most scariest horror movie scenes.
I don't think he's supposed to be Amish. I think he's just supposed to be a preacher from a certain time period.
Right, but he had that same feel, like that same when he was standing in the window. That reminded me of when that preacher walked by the window and just kind of looked in and kept walking by. Like, for some reason, that was a really chilling scene for me. Like, that's like one of the most iconic horror scenes for me. And when he was standing outside our window, that's what I was reminded of. But you know
what's funny? I just had to stop myself going, why am I correcting Crystal about what's Amish and what's not? It's not like we can offend them because they can't watch us. I don't have the internet, I don't think. So I still don't want to be offensive to them, but I'm just
right.
So how are they going to see this?
Oh, the things we think about.
You're trying to be too politically correct.
But the guy in the Poltergeist was Amish. Yes. So like there's
he was not Amish. I'm telling you, he's not Amish.
Okay.
He's just a preacher.
Oh, okay.
Like the 1800s, where a lot of people during that time period, they wore hats like that because it was the 1800s.
Okay. But the scary preacher, the Stitcher reminded me of that. But he wasn't outside by himself. Like there was a whole bunch of people with him. And so they break into her house. She drops her fucking phone. Like, what are you doing? And then she hides behind her big ass, hides behind this little ass fucking desk. Like nobody, the end table with the lamp on it. And she's like, I'm like, how do you not see her? How do you not see her? But she got what she got in the end. So what happened was she tried to escape outside. They drag her back in and they basically sew her mouth shut and then sew a mask over her mouth. So,
and that was cathartic because who else? I mean, who doesn't want to see a Karen get her mouth sewn shut?
And it's a close up too. Like they show it close up, and it's he takes his time, and really good special effects with that. I kind of like that. And like she said, it was cathartic. But
yeah,
that was
a nice satire too.
Satire. Okay, so now we are at Uncle, which I loved a lot. I love the monster in this one. There's like so much, how can I say, the symbolism and the unspoken messages that was in this movie. Mm-hmm. So this little boy goes to an older guy to go down to the mine to make his offering so that his family can be saved. And he is saying that he really doesn't believe in the traditions. And the old man is like, hey, look, you really need to like honor our elders because, you know, they've been here much longer than us and they know better. And so he goes to make his offering, and right at the end, because he's doing everything right, like I was like, you know, when he was first doing his offering, he was pouring out the alcohol and he was leaving the cigarettes, and but like at the last minute he does some flippant little thing, little snot-nosed brat, and then all of a sudden the guy who warned him, everything he warned him about came true. And now this is a stop motion or either clay. It's
I think it's stop motion.
Yeah,
it's, but it could be a computer generated animation that's meant to look like stop motion. I don't know.
But
it was like, how they did it.
One of the things that I really liked is like how expressive the characters were, and like when he was like walking through the mine lost, one of the rocks looked like a face, and then like the way he turned to look, like all those little details is what really makes a really good film. And the story behind it was incredible too, because like when I think he made things worse because he thought he was doing something good. And especially that last scene with them all in there doing what they were doing. I think he just messed it up. And even the old man was like, child, what did you do? That was like, it was so good on so many different levels. The production value of the show, of this short film, I can't even imagine how much they spent, but it was like, there's no complaints whatsoever about this.
I do think that we were supposed to originally think that the little boy was being snot-nosed, but I think the reveal is that what the old man was telling him was not the truth. That the old man was sending him there for a reason, because at the very end, they put a title card that said about the thousands of intentional child deaths in Mexico.
Right.
If are intentional, then that makes it seem like the old man was setting that little boy up.
Oh, maybe you're right. I kind of, like, I didn't think of it like that. And then, like, because, like, not all children who are stolen are sex trafficked. Some of them are forced into child labor. Yes. And so, like, those children, as small as they are, would be the perfect size to be working at a mine like that. So that's like a really good like take on that. I didn't see that until you just mentioned it. I was thinking, you know, him being a brat and you know, because when he came back out, like if he was supposed to go down there and die, the old man wasn't surprised. Like, you know what I mean? Like
he said, what have you done? And it's like I don't know why he didn't want him to save the other children. Like that's the part that I don't understand. He tried to save. Yeah. And the old man is like, what have you done?
Right.
It's almost like logical that he would try to save his brother. Like logical what a child would do. So that's what made me look at the old man. Like, what are your true intentions?
Right. But then like, again, because of the way that it was so symbolic, because like when he brought his brother out of the mine is when he died. Because remember, his brother was trying to stay in the mine. And he's like, let it go. And he yanks him out. And the minute he comes outside, he dies. And then his little soul flies away. And then like the man, he wasn't like he was doing what he was doing. He looked up and he watched the soul fly away. And he's like, child, what have you done? And I was just
I thought that the brother was already dead in the mine. Like, all those children in the mines were, those were the ghosts of those children. And I think that the creature was holding their souls captive. So by him bringing him out, he was, his spirit was free to rise up to heaven rather than being kept in, like, a purgatory or, right, like, a hell of just... I think all of them were, all, those children that were in the mine, they were already dead.
Well, remember, so when he first found his brother, the skin tones were the same. He didn't shrivel up until he came outside.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point.
Like, I think bringing him out of that mine basically set him free, you know, from that life of forced labor, because all of them were children. But it was interesting how once that one soul was set free, then the children and that were left in the mine weren't using the picks anymore. They were banging their heads against
their heads. Yeah, they were banging,
and they were floating off the, you know, ground, like they were maybe 6 feet off the ground, banging their heads on the wall. The monster in that was like really, really good. He was like an amalgamation of like all kinds of different things that you would find in a mine. And then when he pulled his mask off, I was like, oh, okay. So we have another layer to this monster. I'm in love with that monster. I love him a lot. That was Uncle.
Mm-hmm. Now that brings me to the one, the true one that I feel was worse than the Nick.
Okay, and now that you're getting ready to talk about it, I agree with you.
Yes, wait for my call. I just didn't get the point of this. Like, what is the point of this? You didn't, I mean, it's kind of a takeoff on slasher movies, but you didn't achieve anything. It wasn't funny enough to be a parody, right, and it wasn't scary enough to be a slasher. Like, I don't know what your intentions were. It just kind of, it fell flat for me.
Super flat, because like, Even the last girl, I guess, like the stuff that she was doing didn't make any sense. Like, you have a phone, like there had to be some type of a backstory, right? So she calls her friend shows up, and then she tries to kill her with a tire iron. And then the guy she calls runs up and kicks her in the stomach. So like, what? Like, what's going on? And then like how you said, why is a 70-year-old in a Leatherman's jacket? Like,
what? Yeah, you have this grown, well past, well, maybe that's the joke. Because I do know, you know, when you watch a lot of horror movies, they always have, like, 25 and 30-year-olds playing teenagers. So maybe that was meant to be funny, but it didn't, I think you went too far with it. Or you didn't go far enough. You should have had him have, like, a walking cane and some bifocals if you're going to do the whole old teenager thing.
Yeah, it was just, like, we were both, like, what? And yeah. I was completely distracted. Like, normally when I'm, like, judging films or at film festivals, I am watching it because I'm not going to be able to see these films again if they're not in a different film circuit or if they don't end up on Altar. So, but this one, I was, like, I wasn't paying attention, like, because it didn't hold my attention. So, yep, she's right. That one that one wasn't that great. Mm-hmm. Bringing us to the next one, which is Witch, like short for sandwich. This one didn't do it for me either. Like, it was just so, it was so silly, but like, not like, it wasn't silly like The Strangler. It wasn't silly like The Devil's in the Details. It was just.
Oh, I can tell you. I can tell you what's wrong with it, because this is the type of thing that would be up my alley, because I like killer food movies like Attack of the Killer Tomatoes, The Stuff. Where this failed is that when you make a movie like that, you either have to be completely tongue-in-cheek parody, and that's what Attack of the Killer Tomatoes is. Like, the whole movie is a joke, and it's meant to be funny. It's not meant to be taken seriously. It's Killer Tomatoes. How are you going to take that seriously? Right, or the other way you go is you make it extremely gory, and that's what they did with The Stuff. This had neither. The sandwich, you should have had the sandwich bite somebody's fingers off or bite somebody's lip off. That would have been perfect. If he picked up the sandwich like he was going to eat it and didn't know that it had went bad and it bit his lips off, and then you had like some gore, then you, that makes something interesting. You didn't have either element. It wasn't funny and it wasn't gory. So what's the purpose?
Yeah, and then the like last line was just like, it fell flat. Oh, I told you the sandwich went bad. Like, who signed off on this? But okay, thank you for your contribution to this.
Yeah. Insert GIF of Bart Simpson with the cake. At least you try.
I know. Oh my God. And so that brings us to the last film that was extremely beautiful. And me and Sasha both had completely different ideas of what was going on. So let's talk about it.
Zimiena from France.
Yep.
Which also had a really great soundtrack. I don't know why I'm drawing a blank. Sound design. Thank you. Very great sound design, from the forest to the man's nightmares to his time in a room. It really brought everything together, and it got increasingly better looking the longer it went along. It started out looking like a regular short film, but then I feel like it got better as you watched it.
It's a very beautiful film. Mm-hmm. It's very beautiful. And so he is locked in this room, and at first there's like a bunch of bugs and ooze, like goo that's coming out. And so then Sasha was like, you know what? Maybe he's supposed to be a tree, like that's tree sap. And so then as the movie goes further and further along, I was like, you know what? He has post-traumatic stress syndrome, because they're flashing back to the war. And so as soon as she agreed with that, then his hand came out and it looked like tree branches. And I was like, oh my God, there's your tree theory. And so then from there, he becomes more and more like organic. And so my idea was that he died in that forest and his body decomposed and came one with the forest, because once he got out of the room and back into the forest and took off all his clothes, like it shows the floor of the forest, and it's like, and it says mother, like, you know, that's the person talking. She's like, you've come home, my son. So I was like thinking Mother Earth, but like, it's really interesting because wherever he was in that room, like they locked him in. So like maybe his
metamorphosis,
thank you, was like really violent and terrifying from the people who were watching him do that. And I know, being a vet and knowing people who have extreme post-traumatic stress syndrome, some of their breakdowns are, why do you always have your phone on? And who's calling you?
My sister. Jesus. I'm gonna decline and just message her that I'm recording. Reply.
Okay, that's... so start all over. Okay,
sorry about that.
So from being a veteran and knowing other veterans that have post-traumatic stress syndrome, some of their spirals, when they're spiraling and they just can't get a grasp on, you know, what's going on, or they're having really bad flashbacks, some of those can be extremely violent and absolutely terrifying. And it looks like, because of the way that the movie is shot, that he maybe went home to his mom and dad, and they just couldn't deal with a lot of people can't deal with people who are struggling like with like that type of a mental health crisis. And so it looks like he was barred into that room because he couldn't get out. Like it pans out and it shows like where they were, the whole hallway was barred, but the house around it was like decaying, just like going back to the earth. And then like, it seemed like he got out of the window and went back into the forest where he died and was ashes to ashes, dust to dust. He returned to the earth and Mother Earth welcomed him home. It was such a beautiful movie, and it was so many layers, like, you know, how Sasha was thinking it was like, you know, Mother Nature, and I was thinking it was like, you know, shell shock, and it's both. And now that's how you do a monster. Even though he wasn't a monster, his transformation from like man to nature was just incredible. Like the progression of him in different states of decay, but like that decay turning into you know, something that's beneficial for like the plants and the animals and everything that lives in the forest. It was really good. It was super good.
It kind of reminded me of Jacob's Ladder in a way, because it seemed like he was in a state in between life and death.
Yep.
And I now that I look back on it, I'm wondering if the room wasn't actually a room at all, but it represented a coffin.
Ooh.
Because I don't know if you've ever seen Jacob's Ladder, but
I have, but it's been a long time. It's been a long time. And that would make so much sense. Like,
yeah, because he was in Jacob's Ladder. He was actually all the things that he was thinking about being a mailman and all this other stuff actually didn't happen. The whole time he was not in the tent in a medic bed at war. Right. And he was at a state in between life and death. And so when he sees his little son, he takes the stairs with his son going up, and that's him going into heaven and accepting his death. Right. And I think possibly the same thing with this, where he's remembering what happened in war. Those are his last memories, but he doesn't realize that he's in between a state of life and death. And then when he dies and he's put in a coffin, his body returns back to the earth.
I like that.
That's how I interpret it.
Anyway. I mean, and that makes sense too, because like there was nothing. And you know, when they panned out from the door, like, and it was kind of a long, like, you know what I mean? But not wide. It was very long and it showed different parts of decay, like wood breaking down and like a little egg and all kinds of bugs. So like, I like that. I like that analogy. I think that might be even closer to what we were thinking when we were watching it. That was really good. So those are all the movies, and then let's go over the awards. So Uncle, the one that like we liked a lot, got the Minos Awards. And so Minos is the King Judge and Dante's Inferno. So like this is like the big award for Great Plot. So I was super happy to see that they got that one. The most original, they said, was Mine Ease, which, did you think it was the most original?
It had a very original twist, because I didn't see that coming. So I would say if I'm thinking in terms of have I seen it done before, then I probably would say yes, because all the ones that I like the most, I noticed that I compared them with other works. So even though, like, what was the one called? Familiar. As much as I like Familiar, I can name other movies that were like it.
Right.
Or as much as I like, you know, Bloody Bridal Showers, it's a takeoff on other movies. Like, most of the things that I can name that we really liked, we've seen before. Whereas that twist I did not see coming. Although, technically, that's been done before, too.
Right.
Where you, like, in The Others.
Right.
So
like, I was surprised that that it won for most original. I was like, really? Because there were so many other movies on this list that could have been like the one we were just talking about, and No Filter, and like, you know what I mean?
I think the most original would probably be Hombre.
Yep.
With the thin little boy and the fat little boy. I think that's the most original.
Yep, Hombre. So yeah, so that's the one that won for Best Original. Best Director was Uncle, which was the one that we were just like talking a lot about. The Best Film was The Devil in the Details. That was really funny. Like, and it was like, I could kind of see how, you know, they would like that. I'm not upset with that decision. And then the Audience Award went to Uncle again. So like, they kind of like swept, because they have four awards. So they swept this festival this year. This was so fucking fun. I loved the movies. I loved the host. They're just like so chill. This was just like a super cool festival. And and like a lot of the films were really top notch. Like I interviewed them for live action reviews, and I was telling them, like, judging films, like, because I'm a sitting judge on multiple festivals, judging films is getting harder and harder and harder every single year, because these guys are coming with their A games. And so it's a tough, you know, the competition is tough, which great for us who love horror films and like these film festivals. Like, it's like, it's, you know, good for us as like film fans and horror fans, but it's tough to judge. So I'm looking forward to all the amazing movies that I'll be like judging for the rest of the year. But this was an amazing film festival. I'm super happy that we were able to cover it here for Coast2Coast Horror. This is just, it was super fun, super fun.
And we should do a special thank you to Grave Plot Film Fest and GravePlotPodcast.com.
Okay, you guys, thank you so much for your time. Have an amazing weekend, and I'll see you guys on Saturday.
Thank you.
Good.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, you guys. This was an amazing show. Thank you for letting us be a part of it. And we will see you guys next year. But as far as you guys are concerned, our fans, we're going to go ahead and wrap it up. Thank you so much for hanging out with us here at Coast2Coast Horror. I'm going to let Shasha take us off the air.
Thank you again for making it to the end of another episode of Coast2Coast Horror with Crystal and Shasha. Make sure that you are following us on our social media, which we'll have in the description box below. Also, make sure that you're checking the community tab, because sometimes I post on the community tab about what's going on as well. And as always, comment down below, like, comment, subscribe, all that good stuff. You know the deal.
You know the deal. Thank you guys for subscribing, and keep those likes coming. And until our next show, you guys.
Bye-bye.